This video is brought to you by Card Kingdom, and while supplies last, if you mention Saffron Olive in your order notes, we'll hook you up with a free Saffron Olive sticker with any Card Kingdom order. Hello everyone, it's Seth, probably better known as Saffron Olive, and it's time for another daily dose of Throne of Eldraine spoilers. And we have some really interesting cards to talk about today, some spicy stuff, and we should probably jump right into it. Got a big list to go over. Before we start talking cards, a couple of quick reminders. First off, if you haven't already, it would be amazing of you if you could take a second, click that subscribe button down at the bottom of your screen. It's a great way to support the channel and the site for free. Secondly, if you want to see the latest previews, you can find them over at mtgpreviews.com, sortable, filterable, all that good stuff. So let's talk some sweet new Throne of Eldraine cards, starting with Folio of Fancies. And this card, it's kind of spicy. So 2-mana artifact, players, all players, have no maximum hand size, and you can pay double X and tap it, and each player draws X cards, and then you can pay 2 and a blue and tap it, and each opponent, not each player, mills a number of cards equal to the number of cards in their hand. So essentially, this could be a card draw effect. It's also a finisher, all built into one. It's a little tricky to figure out how to use this, so exactly. If you look at what this card does, it's basically a weird double split card of Reliquary Tower with the no maximum hand size static ability, combined with essentially Fascination, a little twist on Fascination, but something that affects all players except for that mill ability, either drawing cards or milling all of our opponents. So how do you actually take advantage of Folio of Fancies? That is the biggest question. And here, there's a few possibilities. First off, in standard, maybe the easiest way to take advantage of it is play it with Narset. If you play this with Narset, you're able to pay that double X. Each player draws X cards, except your opponent can only draw one card each turn. So even if you're doing this during your turn, your opponent only gets to draw one card, and you're probably drawing two or three cards. And if you do it in your opponent's turn, after they've drawn for their turn, they get no advantage from it. They draw zero cards, you get to draw for free, so it can be a pretty insane card advantage engine with the help of Narset's static ability. The other sweet thing you can do in standard is we do have Manifold Key to potentially untap it for just one mana, so if you disregard the Narset plan and actually let your opponent get a big handful of cards, then Folio Fancies could actually be a really fast mill plan. Let's say your opponent has seven cards in hand, you sneak this in early underneath their counter magic or whatever, you can pay 3 mana, tap it, mill your opponent for 7, Manifold Key, 1 mana, untap it, do it again for 3 more mana, that's 7 more mana, mill for 7 more, that's 14 cards, and you can potentially just keep doing that, turn after turn after turn after turn, or if you got a bunch of mana, you can make your opponent draw a bunch of cards, untap it, then mill your opponent, so it can be a good card advantage engine, especially when Narset can be a mill finisher. The other place I really like this card is in Group Hug Commander decks. If you're playing a Feldegriff deck, maybe in Brawl you have Kenrith, or in Commander you have Kenrith, but some sort of group hug style deck, then Folio Fancies is super sweet because it's doing exactly what you want to do in group hug. You're helping your opponent by allowing them to draw cards, but you're also benefiting you. And then the nice thing about Folio Fancies is eventually it turns around into a win condition, milling your opponent's stuff, potentially milling your opponent out of the game. Also in modern, and this might be a stretch, but we do have Paradox Edge decks, we do have Urza decks floating around with a shell like Paradoxical Urza. Folio Fancies is a pretty insane win condition. You make a ton of mana thanks to Urza tapping all your artifacts and Paradox Engine untapping them. You can draw whatever cards you need with the double X ability. Your opponent's also going to be drawing cards. Presumably they're tapped out as you're comboing off or whatever. And then you just mill your opponent out of the game. So the combination of being a card draw engine and being a win condition and also being fairly cheap and just an artifact that's on the battlefield to turn on your Mox Opals to support your Urza plan might actually give this a shot in small numbers in modern as well. So Group Hug Commander's Table, janky tricks in standard, and maybe some Urza action in modern. Super sweet card all around in Folio of Fancies. Next on our list, we got Dance of the Manse. And this card is kind of spicy. 2 mana, white and blue, plus X. You get to return X target artifacts and or non-or enchantments each with a converted mana cost of X or less from your graveyard to the battlefield. If X is 6 or more, they become 4/4 creatures in addition to their other types. So basically, expensive mass reanimation for artifacts. And this is a card that I think is pretty clearly geared towards two formats, Commander and Brawl. Not that it doesn't have any potential in Standard or in Modern, but those are the main homes for this card. If you're playing an artifact-based Commander deck, it can be very strong. So as far as comparisons for Dance of the Mats, I actually don't know. There's nothing exactly like this. Kind of reminds me a little bit of like Immortal Servitude, Return to the Ranks, Rally the Ancestors, these mass reanimation effects. And then if you can cast it big enough, you kind of get this Starfield of Nyx. Turn your artifacts and or non-aura enchantments into 4/4s, beat your opponent down. So that's actually kind of sweet. It can be a finisher. If you can stock your graveyard with enough stuff, cast this with enough mana, you get back a bunch of artifacts and enchantments that you turn into 4/4s, potentially just beat your opponent. So there's definitely potential there, and that might be the easiest way to play it in Standard. Some sort of self-mill deck, mill a bunch of cheap artifacts and enchantments, try to ramp up enough that you can cast this with X being at least 6, get back a huge board full of 4/4s, and hopefully use them to kill your opponent, maybe even at instant speed with the help of Teferi or something. But really, like I said, the place I'm most excited for Dance of the Mats is in Commander. There are powerful artifact decks, Breas and Hanaship Navigator, Shroom the Hegemon. If you're playing an artifact-themed deck, especially in a format like Commander, where big mana is kind of what's going on, with mana rocks and all that stuff, it's easy to cast this with X being 6 or more. With a little bit of graveyard synergy, stocking your graveyard, or even just getting back artifacts that die, then Dance of the Mats, very strong, being able to get back a bunch of artifacts all at once, maybe even turn them into creatures. The same is also true of some enchantment. Actually, you got Tetsuva and Estrid and Xur the Enchanter. Again, Dance of the Mats is a way you can get back a bunch of your key cards that have died, like a mass Eternal Witness, putting them right to the battlefield, maybe even making them into creatures. So I think if you're playing a artifact or enchantment Commander deck in blue and white, or Bant, these three color decks, whatever, then you're definitely considering this card, because your artifacts and enchantments are going to die. People know that Commander has a lot of powerful artifacts and enchantments, so they play their Crows and Grips and their mass artifact and enchantment destruction spells. So having a way to get around that is very sweet. Also, in Standard, well, actually Brawl, there is some potential as well. There's not many artifact or enchantment based commanders for Brawl at this point, but Alea Artful Provocateur, that's probably the best of the bunch. You want a bunch of artifacts and enchantments to support your Alea, make a bunch of fairies. Dance of the Mats, great way to get back those cards from the graveyard, so I think it's an easy inclusion if you're playing Alea Brawl. Also, like, Dovin kind of cares about artifacts, making Thopter tokens. If you're playing Dovin, I think it's in the conversation, but it depends on your build. Otherwise, we do have some standard payoffs for artifacts and enchantments, and we are getting more in Throne of Eldraine, but really, I think this is a card to keep an eye out for in the future. We have, like, Starfield Mystic kind of pushes us towards enchantments, which I expect we'll get more of in Theros. We have Steel Overseer, Tezzeret Master of the Bridge. Maybe there's some way to make this work in Standard, but really, I think we might be too limited in artifact and enchantment targets right now, so this might be more of a wait until we get more sets in Standard, and then maybe Dance of the Mats is going to be a card that actually has a chance in the format. So, great card for Commander in artifact or enchantment decks. Possible in Brawl, in Alea in specific, or other artifact and enchantment based decks. Standard wise, I don't expect it to see much play right away, but moving forward, as we get Theros, as we get more sets, then all of a sudden it might be in the conversation. We also got one of the best adventures we've seen yet, Bone Crusher Jaya, and this is one of the adventures I think is most geared for constructed play. We've seen a lot of sweet adventures. A lot of adventures seem good and limited. This is one when you read it, you're like, okay, this is supposed to be a constructed card. So 3 mana 4/3 giant, whenever it becomes a target of a spell, it deals 2 damage to that spell's controller. So kind of a weird form of protection. And the instant adventure half is a shock where damage can't be prevented this turn. So Bone Crusher Giant, first off, the shock half of it is actually pretty nice. You're paying 1 more mana, which is more than you want to pay for a shock. You don't get excited about a 2 mana shock. However, there are some cards that the damage prevention, not being able to be prevented, it is actually relevant against. Like, Gideon Blackblade, for example. That card is really annoying because the damage is prevented to it. Being able to turn off damage prevention with Stomp and then kill Gideon, that's relevant. That's a thing. You can use your Stomp and then a shock, kill the Gideon. That's a very relevant play. Or, God forbid, there's another Fog deck that comes around. I think maybe we've moved past that now that Nexus of Fate have rotated. But if there's a shock deck where your opponent's just like, Root Snare, Root Snare, Root snare, draw cards, root snare, do that again and again and again, drive you crazy until you want to quit magic. Bone Crusher Giant is going to be great there as well because of the stomp path. You just cast it, shock something, make it so damage can't be prevented, and then you get in your big attack, kill your opponent even through the fog effect. The other thing about damage prevention is it's a way to get through protection abilities, which is also surprisingly relevant. We have like Shifting Ceratops, we have Stone Coil Serpent, we'll talk more about that later, another new protection card, God's willing. Protection is essentially a damage prevention ability. So Bone Crusher Giant turning off damage prevention means that all of a sudden your Shifting Ceratops will trade off with a blue creature, or Stone Coil Serpent with a multicolored creature, or you could like fizzle a God's Willing essentially and kill that feather that's driving you crazy. So I think the stomp path very relevant, but especially relevant because it's attached to a really good creature. A 4-3 for 3 is already good stats. Those are solid standard stats, and the protection ability, the 2 damage when it's targeted, reminds me a little bit of Thunderbreak Regent. So Thunderbreak Regent, a little bit better. It was 3 damage if it or any dragon was targeted. However, what this means is if you're playing a deck like Mono Red, your Bone Crusher Giant, you can shock something, you can cast it from exile the next turn, you get a on curve from arguably even above curve body as a 4-3 for 3, and then if your opponent needs to deal with your Bone Crusher Giant, they lightning strike it or whatever, worst case, you're getting 2 damage out of it, even if you don't get in an attack. So it's 2 damage from stop, 2 more damage from Bone Crusher Giant, all together for your investment, you're getting a total of 4 damage, and that's fine. That is fine in your Mono Red deck, and you're going to put your opponent in your Mono Red deck in a really tight position. They need to kill Bone Crusher so you don't die to combat damage, but if they kill Bone Crusher, they're going to take damage from it, getting their life total lower in burn range. And worth mentioning, Mono Red's still got a lot of pieces. I know we're losing like Goblin Chain Whirler. I think Bone Crusher might be the best replacement we've seen so far in the 3-drop slot for Mono Red decks, but we're gaining Slaying Fire, which is actually a very strong card for a Mono Red deck. 4 damage, instant speed, 3 mana, very solid. And we still have like Runaway Steamkin, we still have Experimental Frenzy. So if you're hoping for the demise of Mono Red, I don't think it's happening yet. I expect there to be a Mono Red deck in Standard, and I expect that Bone Crusher Giant just kind of slides into that Chain Whirler slot as a easy 4 of in your Mono Red aggro decks. Could even show up in other decks, Gruul Stompy decks, anything like that. It is a very, very strong card. Split card of an above the curve, or at least on curve body with some weird protection, combined with a slightly bad shock with upside of damage prevention. This is a card that's going to show up in Standard. It reminds me of the Hero's Downfall adventure, where it's one of the adventures you read and you're like, all right, this is an adventure that they're gearing for Standard, and I expect Bone Crusher Giant to be crushing modes in aggro decks and Standard for the next couple years. It is just a very good Magic card. We also got Vantress Gargoyle, and this card is spicy, and I want to be excited about it, but my guess is it's a little bit worse than it looks. So 2 mana, 5-4 flying. Just reading that, the stats are pretty insane, except it can't attack unless defending player has 7 or more cards in their graveyard. It can't block unless you have 4 or more cards in hand, but you can tap it to mill everyone. Tap it, each player mills a card, so it does fuel itself eventually. I think the easiest comparison for me with this is Jace's Phantasm. Jace's Phantasm, kind of the same type of paradigm, where it's undercosted, can be a 5-5 flyer for 1, but you need to meet a condition to actually turn it into that. Jace's Phantasm needs 10 cards in the graveyard. Vantress Gargoyle only needs 7, but still, it's going to take a little bit. If you play this on turn 2, you're not going to start beating down with it immediately in Standard. It's going to take some work to get the cards in the graveyard, which also makes it a little bit like Sarah Avenger, another card that is an undercosted 2-mana flyer as a 3-3 flying vigilance for 2, but you can't cast it until it least the fourth turn, so it's kind of naturally safe. Same with Vantress Gargoyle. I will say, it is sweet that if you want to build like weird janky mill aggro in Modern, having Jace's Phantasm and Vantress Gargoyle, play your Tome Scours or whatever on turn 1, get cards in the graveyard, play these, you're gonna have some big flying threats that can close out the game quickly. So maybe that can develop into a new Modern budget deck, like aggro blue mill, where you play these flyers that needs cards in your opponent's graveyard, try to just kill your opponent in the air with 5 power flyers really quickly. As far as Standard is concerned, I don't know. We have some pieces to support Vantress Gargoyle. We have Drowned Secret still. A powerful blue mill card. We have Jace Wielder of Mysteries milling those cards as it ticks up. We have Folio of Fancies. A little bit slow, but really if you play this on turn 2, activate it on turn 3, you're probably milling close to 7 cards, at least like 5 cards or something, of your opponents right away. So there are ways to turn it on. Is it going to be worth building around in Standard? We'll have to wait and see. Again, I think this could be a sweet budget deck in Standard. Mono blue mill with Vantress Gargoyle as a finisher, we do have pieces to support it, but I think that the restrictions make it safer than it looks. Don't look at this as a 2-mana 5-4, because it's not going to be attacking on turn 3 in the air for 5. It will be blocking, most likely, if you have enough cards in hand, but it's more of a late-game card, where at 2-mana, you can play this and leave up a counter spell, maybe on turn 4 or turn 5, or leave up a removal spell, get a big threat, protect the big threat, hopefully use it to kill your opponent. So, a little bit different than it looks. Don't look at it as a normal creature, but it definitely is powerful. Anytime you see big evasive stats for 2-mana, even with a bunch of weird conditions to be met, it's worth taking note of. So if you could build around this correctly, it could be very powerful, both in Standard and potentially in budget modern decks, alongside Jace's Phantasm as well. Next on our list, we enter the world of Mythic Rares with the Magic Mirror, and this card, 9-mana legendary artifact, except it's actually not really 9-mana. Triple blue costs 1 less to cast for each instant or sorcery in your graveyard, so if you can get 6 or more instant or sorceries, only 3-mana. Makes it so you have no maximum hand size, and then at the beginning of your upkeep, you get to put a counter on the Magic Mirror and draw a card for each knowledge counter that is put onto it. So you play it, the next turn you draw a card, the turn after that 2 cards, turn after that 3 cards. So if it gets you down the battlefield, it is an insane source of card advantage. So let's talk a little bit about this card. The easiest comparison is Minds Unbound. There's some twists here and differences. Mind Unbound, always 6 mana, but it has essentially the same ability. At the beginning of your upkeep, you get a counter, then you draw a card for each counter. The Magic Mirror has the upside, several upsides really, no maximum hand size. That is an upside if you're drawing a ton of cards. Potentially being 3-mana in the right deck, also an upside. So there is a lot of upside compared to Mind Unbound, which is good because Minds Unbound didn't really see play from what I can remember. The problem I have with Magic Mirror in Standard is it's not a good format for cards that need to sit out on the battlefield to slowly gain value. In our current Standard format, there's a lot of Teferis, there's a lot of Knight of Autumns, there's a lot of Assassin's Trophies. These are cards that are in main deck, so it's not like after sideboard you get blown out. These are cards that are just sitting in people's main decks, waiting to ruin your Magic Mirror plan. So you just play your Magic Mirror, then your opponent bounces it with Teferi, or they kill it with Knight of Autumn, or they Assassin's Trophy it, so it's hard for me to imagine this just sitting out on the battlefield long enough in most matchups to actually generate the value. Maybe you could bring it in against like Demir Control and the Control Mirror and you'll win the mirror with it or whatever, but I think it's pretty narrow in what matchups it'll shine in Standard. On the other hand, this card feels built for Spellslinger Commander decks. If you are looking to play Talrand or Melek or the new Savine, this card seems perfect because you're already getting a ton of spells in your graveyard. This is always going to be 3-mana and your opponents might not worry about it right away. Like the first turn, you're only drawing a card. The next turn is only 2 cards. It's really not till the 3rd or 4th turn that you get up to the danger zone where you're drawing a ton of cards, and by that time maybe you got some counter spells to protect it or whatever. So I feel like Spellslinger Commander decks, also Spellslinger Brawl decks, since we've talked about a lot about Brawl with Wizards pushing it with this set, Alea Artful Provocateur, perfect for that. You're playing a ton of spells, you want to play artifacts to trigger your Alea anyway, Kaiker, Niv-Mizzet, Perun. So if you're playing a Spellslinging style Brawl deck, also worth keeping Magic Mirror in mind. So it's a card that I feel like probably not going to see Standard play, but in multiplayer Commander games, especially in Spellslinger decks, and maybe in Brawl as well, Magic Mirror gives you a really strong source of card advantage if it can sit out on the battlefield for a few turns. Next on our list, oh my god, Iron Craig Feat, and this card is scary. So Iron Craig Feat, 4-mana, triple red and colorless, add 7 red mana to your mana pool, but you can only cast 1 more spell this turn. So this is a card that I'm kind of surprised was printed. Wizards is very conservative with their rituals, and if you look at Ironcrag Feat, it is essentially a Seething Song. You're gaining so much mana off this card. You pay 1 more up front, but you're going from 4 mana to 7 mana. Seething Song goes from 3 mana to 5 mana. The downside is you can't play it in the decks that traditionally want rituals. Normally when you play a ritual deck, deck, you're playing some sort of storm combo deck and looking to cast a bunch of spells, get a bunch of mana, eventually Grapeshot, Pass and Flame, win the game that way. Ironclad Feat, because of the you can only cast one more spell this turn clause, makes it basically impossible to play in storm. So how do you use a ritual that only allows you to cast one spell after you cast your ritual? And the answer is you try to cast one big spell. We get 7 red mana off of Ironclad Feat. So let's think about Modern, for example. Let's consider the absolute dream draw. It is turn 1. Your hand is 3 Simian Spirit Guides, a mountain, an Ironclad Feat, a card liberated. You exile your Simian Spirit Guides, you play your mountain, you play Ironclad Feat, brings you up to 7 mana, you play a card liberated. I mean, that's a little bit magical Christmas land, but really, if you look at a deck like Mono Red Prison, they're playing Simian Spirit Guides. They're emptying their hand for Ensnaring Bridge. So even though turn 1 is obviously, that's a dream, that's a miracle when that happens, it's not going to be all that uncommon for a deck with Simian Spirit Guides, Desperate Rituals, to maybe be able to cast this on turn 2 and then cast something massive like Karn, even racing a deck like Tron to Karn. And you can do the same thing in Standard, and it's extremely frightening. Like, picture this in Standard. On turn 1, I don't know, you play a tap land. Turn 2, you play an Incubation Druid or Paradise Druid. Turn 3, you make your land drop, you tap your Mana Dork, you tap your 3 lands, you Ironclad Feat, you play a Shadra Awakened Inferno. On turn 3, start wrathing your opponent's board, giving your opponent counters to deal them damage. It can't even be countered. It seems absolutely absurd. Plus, remember, we are still in Standard with Thousand Year Storm. So if you want to go really insane, you play a Thousand Year Storm deck, then you make Ironclad Feat your last card cast before your finisher, you copy it, I don't know, 10 times, whatever, make 70 mana, and then your one spell is like Explosion to smash your opponent's face for 1,000,000 damage, whatever finisher you want to use. So that sounds fun as well. So Ironclad Feat, this card is really unique. It is really scary. It's a ritual you can't abuse in the typical ritual way, but I have no doubt that it is powerful. Going from 4 mana to 7 mana can do some busted things, so I don't know. It'll be very interesting to see how this plays out. It is undoubtedly a powerful Magic card. Can people find the right shell to play that turn 2 Karn, play that turn 3 Chandra Awakened Inferno, and actually make it consistent? That's the question, because if you don't have your finisher, then your Ironclad Feat just not really doing anything. So it's going to take some brewing to figure this card out, but if someone gets this right and is turn 2 Karning, turn 3 Chandraing, it is going to be pretty busted and pretty powerful. So super unique, and I'm almost surprised Wizards printed this. They're so conservative with rituals, and even with the only one more spell this turn clause, this card is very good. Next on our list, we have our exclusive MTG Goldfish preview card, Mirror Maid. So this card, I wrote an article for. It's on the website. I'll link it in the description. If you want a full breakdown of this card, make sure to check out that article. Thank you so much to Wizards for hooking us up with it. So Mirror Maid, 3 mana enchantment, enters the battlefield as a copy of any artifact or enchantment on the battlefield. So I think Wizards heard that I love Blood Moon, I love Panharmonicon, so they gave me a preview card that technically could be a Blood Moon or a Panharmonicon for just 3 mana. So Mirror Maid, it's very interesting. It is essentially the next in a lineage of copy artifact and copy enchantment. Copy artifact, same card, 1 less mana, can't hit enchantments. Copy enchantment, same card, same mana essentially, except -1 blue +1 colorless, can't hit artifacts. Mirror Maid is doing what these cards do, but better essentially. And I think the easiest home for Mirror Maid is going to be in Commander. In Commander, there's not a whole lot of downside to this, because worst case, it's a 3 mana mana rock. You copy one of your opponent's signets. Best case, you're snagging like Mirari's Wake or some busted enchantment, some huge creature, a Wyrmcoil Legend, whatever that your opponent plays. So I think Mirror Maid, the floor is so high, because worst case in Commander, you just always copy a mana rock, you're fine. At like 3 mana for a signet's not great, but whatever, you can deal with that, that's still not bad. And the upside is very high, so definitely in the conversation for Commander. In Standard, ugh, I'm not sure what to do with this card. We've talked about this a lot with our artifact enchantment cards that we've seen coming out of Throne of Eldraine. Is there enough support to make it work? Obviously, your opponent plays Bolas the Citadel, you copy it for 3 mana, you combo off, that's awesome. You have a Meteor Golem, you get a copy of it for 3 mana, that's great. Maybe another captive audience. There are things that you can copy with Mirror Maid, but you really need a critical mass of good targets before you put this in your deck, and I'm just not sure we have it in Standard. In Modern, there's a couple of possibilities. piece. I'm not super duper high on it seeing play, but there are a couple of decks where I think Mirror Maid can definitely show up as a one of, specifically as a tutor target. So the easiest here is Xur the Enchanter. Xur already wants a bunch of enchantments, converted mana cost 3 or less. You're stacking up Ghostly Prisons, etc., etc., etc. Maybe you're getting Phyrexian Unlife with Solemnity. Mirror Maid can be any of those cards. So you play it as a one of, you let it sit in your deck, you tutor it out, copy whatever you need in a given situation. Perfect card for Xur decks in Modern. Similarly, especially if you have blue mana, which you don't always, but Enduring Ideal could also take advantage of this. Another deck that can tutor out enchantments. In Mirror Maid, play it as a one of, tutor it out, copy your best enchantment. Seems good there as well. However, where I'm very confident that Mirror Maid will see play is in the Commander format, because in Commander, both copy artifact and copy enchantment see play. So artifact decks play these cards because you can copy your own powerful artifacts, often in a discount. Enchantment decks or Zedru decks also play these cards. You copy a bad enchantment or artifact, give it to your opponent. Shaka Seba Clone Tribal will want it as well. So if you are playing copy enchantment in your Commander deck, Mirror Maid is just better. Yes, the mana cost a little bit harder. Don't worry about it. It's a strict upgrade because it's a copy enchantment that can snag your opponent's Signet or their Gilded Lotus or whatever. If you're playing copy artifact, you might play Mirror Maid. One more mana. It depends on how fast you're trying to be. If you're a fast combo deck, then you might not play it. But I think this is going to be a Commander staple in clone decks, in artifact decks, in enchantment decks. And maybe you just play it anyway because 3 mana to copy a Signet is the floor. And that's pretty high floor in the Commander format. On the other hand, this is a weird card to talk about because it's only as powerful as what's on the battlefield. I really dug around to try to find combos for it, and there's no specific combo with Mirror Maid. However, Copy Artifact is part of a competitive EDH combo that mostly involves copying your own Isochron Scepter. So you try to get like Isochron Scepter with Dramatic Reversal for infinite mana. Then you use Mirror Maid to copy your Scepter and put a finisher under it to go with your infinite untapping. You put a Swan Song, make infinite swans or whatever. So you can use it as like a support piece to combo, but really, I think this is mostly a value card in all formats. 3 mana to clone an artifact and enchantment, really decent. If you're playing copy enchantment, if you're playing copy artifact, Mirror Maid might just be better than either, especially in a format like Commander, where powerful artifacts and enchantment are kind of the basis of the format. We also got a nice little uncommon in Revenge of Ravens. The birds are coming. 4 mana enchantment, and it makes it so whenever a creature attacks you or a planeswalker you control, that creature's controller loses a life and you gain a life. So this is not a card I imagine playing in the main deck in Standard, but it seems like it could be a good sideboard hoser, specifically against token decks. If your opponent's plan is to go wide with 1/1s, Revenge of Ravens basically makes it so your opponent can't really attack you. They attack with a bunch of 1/1s, you gain that life back, they get drained. So really good hate for token decks in Standard. Also might be good enough as sideboard hate against like mono red, especially go wide mono red decks with a bunch of creatures. Gonna make it hard for your opponent to kill you. You're buffering your life total. So a really cool card. Seems like it's great for hating on tokens, maybe good against mono red aggro as well, and definitely a unique effect with some sweet art, and I'm glad I'm not that guy with my eyes getting torn out by ravens. So next on our list, we got Oathsworn Knight, and this card is awesome. I don't know if it's good, but it is awesome. It is basically a top-down design of the Black Knight from Monty Python's Holy Grail. So 3 mana 0/0 enters with 4 counters. It attacks each combat, just like the Black Knight, and then, whenever it's dealt damage, you remove a +1/+1 counter from it, as long as it has a counter, and you prevent that damage. So, basically, you attack, it gets chump blocked, you get your arm cut off, then you get your next arm cut off, then your leg cut off. So, I love the design and flavor of this card. As far as playing this card, its intro stats coming into play as a 4/4 for 3 are good. That's like Loxodon Smiter stats. That's above the curve as a 3 drop. And then it has like a weird fixed version of the Phantom mechanic from way back in Judgment. The fixedness of it is because it only prevents the damage if there's a counter to remove, it's a lot safer. With something like Phantom Tiger, if you play an Anthem, you can just essentially have a Phantom Tiger that lives forever, blocks infinitely, attacks infinitely. Even once it runs out of counters, the damage just keeps being prevented. Oathsworn Knight is fixed to the sets that you only get to prevent the damage if it has a plus one counter on it to remove. So not going to go infinite in the way some of the old Phantom creatures were. I think the best way to play this card in Standard is some sort of tempo deck, because if it gets jumped, it's going to shrink, become less relevant. So if you play some sort of like Rakdos or Mono Black tempo where you can clear blockers out of the way, play this as an undercosted threat as a 4-4 for 3, get in a lot of damage quickly, that seems like where Oathsworn Knight will shine. The problem I have with this, as far as Knight Tribal in specific, is we've already got two really good black 3-drop knights. Midnight Reaper, very powerful go long card if you got Aristocrats, Sacrifice synergies, even better. And then we have Murderous Rider, which I expect to be extremely heavily played as a Hero's Downfall with upside. So can Oathsworn Knight actually beat out the existing knights that we have in Knight Tribal in the 3-drop black slot? I'm not exactly sure, as much as I love the design. On the other hand, the more cards we see, the more I'm getting a little high on some sort of like mono black aggro deck, maybe with some knight synergies thrown in. The curve is looking really strong. Knight of the Eben Legion, Order of Midnight, we have Oathsworn Knight, we have Arya, so we have a lot of cards to make mono black aggro work. So I don't know how this is going to shake out. I'm skeptical of the mechanic, because even though it looks like a 4-4 for 3, it's quickly going to be worse and worse as it's chump blocked, as it takes damage. However, a 4-4 for 3 is good, and I definitely love the top down flavor of this card. Next on our list, we got Fae Burrow Elder, and this card is pretty exciting. So, 3 mana in the Selesnya colors. It has Vigilance. It gets +1/+1 for each color among permanents you control. So, by itself, it's a 2/2 Vigilance. But if you have all 5 colors of permanents, it's going to be a 5/5 for 3, and you can tap it and add a mana for each color permanents you control. So, if you have all 5 colors of permanents on the battlefield, you tap Fae Burrow Elder for 5 mana, which is incredibly powerful. So the comparison here is Bloom Tender. Bloom Tender shows up in multicolor commander decks, can add a lot of mana. Fae Burrow Elder, it costs an additional mana, so not as explosive. However, it makes up for that by having a much more relevant body as potentially a 5/5 for 3, or worst case, a 2/2 for 3. So how do we evaluate Fae Burrow Elder? And I think the trick here is you want it to tap for at least 3 mana consistently. We have a pretty long line of 3 drops that tap for 2 mana. And while I think Fae Burrow Elder is probably better than those, with a better body, with more abilities, those cards haven't typically been that playable in Standard. We don't see Gyre Engineers running around. Palladium Mirror, I think there was like a Wormcoil deck that played it, but for the most part, a 3-drop that taps for 2 mana isn't generally good enough for Standard. On the other hand, if you have a 3-drop that taps for 3 or more mana, that's where you get cards that are often very powerful and playable. Elvish Archdruid, Somberwald Sage, was played in Standard, Hoof People Out, Axe Bay Guardian, can tap for a lot of mana. So I think that's what you got to try to do with Fae Burrow Elder, is make sure you have at least 3 different colors of permanents. If you're playing straight Selesnya, I don't think you want it. If you're playing 3 colors, or especially 5 colors, then this card can be insane. The first thing I thought of when I saw Fae Burrow Elder is, not for Modern, but for Standard Nimbazit Reborn. Nimbazit Reborn is a powerful card. It's 5 colors. Fae Burrow Elder is essentially built for that deck. You play this on turn number 3. It gives you the mana to cast Nimbazit on turn number 4, even without any additional help, and then after you have Niv down, you have a Fae Burrow Elder that's a 5/5 Vigilance that's tapping for 5 mana, just explode out of the gates, casting all the cards that you drew with your Nimbazit Reborn. So this seems like the perfect ramp spell for 5 color Niv, so I'm actually really excited for this. I love Niv decks. I think Fae Burrow Elder, good to see play in casual formats, great in Commander, probably a better Bloom Tender if you're in those colors, even though it costs 1 more mana, and I can't wait to Niv people out with it in Standard, because it seems absolutely built to support Niv-Mizzet. We also got Stone Coil Serpent, another protection card. X mana for a 0/0, comes into play with X counters on it, but it has reach, it has trample, and it has protection from multicolored. So this is the next in a line of a type of creature we've seen a lot lately. Ugin's Conjurer, Endless One, the X spell 0/0s that you can scale up as the game goes along. So Stone Coil Serpent, it can be a 2/2 for 2, a 3/3 3-for-3 or 4-4-for-4. It is never really above the curve, but it is better than the other options, the endless ones, the Ugin's Conjurates, because it has so many mechanics. Having reach is great. Trample, really helpful. You can cast it for 10 mana of a 10-10 trample. That's insane. And protection from multicolor is actually pretty relevant with this card. It means if you dump all your mana into this, it's not getting bounced by Teferi or mortified immediately. It also means that thanks to reach, you can use this to block feathers forever. It has protection. Even if your feather is bigger, you play as a 1-1 for one and just stonewall a feather. Or you play it with a bunch of mana and take down a Hydroid Crosses. So since we're coming out of a Return to Ravnica with so many multicolor cards, I actually think this is a really solid card. I'm not sure who main decks it. Maybe no one main decks it, but at least it's a good sideboard card, and this is way better than the previous versions that we've seen, the endless ones, the Ugin Conjurants, because it has so many more mechanics. Trample, super relevant on a creature like this. Reach, a nice upside, and in our current format, protection from monocolor is super sweet. So worst case, this is a sideboard card, kind of like Sorcerer's Spyglass, that any deck can play to shut down multicolor cards, and best case, there's a deck that wants it in the main deck, and it's absolutely bonkers. Finally today, we get some lower rarity stuff, stuff that's pretty much just relevant for limited. Not gonna spend much time on it because, yeah, we've already gone pretty long with a lot of cards to talk about today, but worth mentioning they exist. And anyway, that brings us to the end of our daily Throne of Eldraine spoilers for today. So what do you think of these busted cards? How good is the Magic Mirror? Can that do anything in standard? How much of a standard staple is Bone Crusher Giant for mono red? Is playing turn one card or turn three whatever Chandra off of Incraig Feet going to be a thing in standard and modern? What about Vantress Gargoyle? Is the downside too much, or can it actually fight through? Can Stone Coil Serpent stonewall some big threats in the format? Folio of Fancies, what do you want to do with that? How insane is Fae Burrow Elder potentially adding 5 mana with Niv running around? Oathsworn Knight, is that good or just flavorful? Let me know what you think in the comments. Thank you so much for watching. I hope you all enjoyed the video, and I will talk to you soon. Thanks for watching the video. If you enjoyed it, help us out by clicking that like button down below. And to keep up on all the latest and greatest, click that subscribe button. And don't forget to hit that bell icon to get alerts whenever we have new videos. And if you want to, check out some of our other sweet videos here and here.